That unique waltz in 5/4 time was dedicated to Tchaikovsky's young nephew, Vladimir Davydov, nicknamed Bob. The boy had been the apple of Tchaikovsky's eye since early childhood, and as he entered his teens, he was fast becoming the single greatest source of pleasure and consolation in Tchaikovsky's day-to-day life. In 1884, when Bob was 13, Tchaikovsky, now 44, wrote to Modeste in ebullient mood.
Ah, our friendship is terrific. And do you know, for the first time he displays a strong liking for me. Formerly he only allowed himself to be adored, while now he seems to have begun to value my adoration. And truly I do adore him, and the longer the more powerfully. What a delightful specimen of humankind he is.
But it's in his diaries rather than his correspondence that we learn most about the full extent of Tchaikovsky's adoration.
May 1st, 1884. Before supper, played piano duet with my darling, incomparable, wonderful, ideal Bob. In the end, he will simply drive me mad with his indescribable charm. As soon as I am not working, I start longing for Bob and missing him. I do love him terribly. Oh, Lord, I do.
Fully 8 years later, Tchaikovsky's love for his nephew, now 21, had become something like an obsession, all of which must have been hard going for Bob, who didn't reciprocate Tchaikovsky's feelings, something which Tchaikovsky himself seems not to have understood until the last year of his life. In December of 1890, Tchaikovsky's latest opera, The Queen of Spades, scored a tremendous hit when it was first produced in St. Petersburg, leading quickly to a double commission from the Imperial Theatre there for one ballet and a one-act opera. But before he could complete either, Tchaikovsky crossed the Atlantic for the first time to make his conducting debut in the United States, followed by a brief tour which took in New York, Philadelphia, and Baltimore, and included trips to Washington, D.C., and most unforgettably, to Niagara Falls. His state of mind as he set off was low even by his standards, and was deepened still further by the death of his sister Alexandra, which he discovered on the last page of a newspaper on the very brink of his departure.
I rushed out of the room as though I had been stung. After wandering the streets without any sense of the time, I went round to see Sophie Mentor and Vasya Sapelnikov. It was my great good fortune that they were in. I spent the night at their place. At first I thought it was my duty to abandon America and go to Petersburg, but then I realized that that was pointless. But my mental sufferings are very great. I fear dreadfully for Bob, though I know from experience that at his age such misfortunes are borne comparatively lightly.
After a crossing which cured him of the idea that he wasn't susceptible to seasickness, he arrived in the New World and found that it surpassed his highest expectations.
New York, American customs, American hospitality, the very appearance of the town, the remarkable comfort of my accommodation, all this is very much to my taste. And if I were younger, I would probably be greatly enjoying my stay in this interesting new country. But I'm enduring all this as though it were a mild form of punishment, which the agreeable circumstances make less rigorous. My thoughts and aspirations are as one. Home, home, home. People here could not be kinder. They honour me, they entertain me. It seems that I am 10 times better known in America than I am in Europe. When they first told me that, I thought it was exaggerated kindness. But now I can see that it's true. There are some pieces of mine which they still don't know in Moscow. Here they play them several times in a season and write whole articles and commentaries about them. Hamlet, for instance. They've played the Fifth Symphony 2 years running. Isn't this funny? At the rehearsals, the players gave me a very enthusiastic reception. And they played superbly.